To be here, and I hope that it is the same with you. We are here to celebrate a milestone. Ken and Maggie have been together for 15 years. They've tested and tried this love relationship, and they find it worthy enough to bring us here today to finally put our stamp of approval on it. And we are happy to do that, right? I always say that love is a beautiful thing. When you find it, you give it a home. Ken and Maggie found it 15 years ago. They gave it a home. It has grown. And we are here to celebrate. This is the kind of love that you celebrate with abandon. It has been tested. It has been tried. And it is thriving. Nothing here to wonder how it will feel like the next day. Nothing here to wonder how it would look like in the next year. It has succeeded for 15 long years. Amen? And if you look this way, you're going to see two cakes. That tells you that we have another celebration here. Maggie's Diamond Celebration. So, welcome once more. And we are ready for the bridal party to come in. This was a special request by Ken. Bank alert. What a wonderful day. Yes, Ken has earned the right. And it is now time for Ken to receive his bride. And I hope I don't cry. Because what I am seeing at the door is marvelous in my eyes, and it will be marvelous in your eyes, in the sight of the woman God, where you see the daughter bringing in her mother. She's clad in the dignity of her profession. How wonderful, Dr. Mirabel, to see your mother anchor in your arms. I've seen you anchor on her arms many times over in this life. And such is life, that mothers bring up daughters. But it is a way of our God that there comes a time when mothers can hang on daughters. That means we have succeeded beyond measure. Maggie, you are blessed. It's not often that we see this. It's not often that you can raise a child who can anchor you at this time in life. Can we give a round of applause to Mirabel? Congratulations, Maggie. Congratulations. How wonderful. What a moment. What a moment. Take your time. You'll dance at the center. Yes. Right now. What we've been waiting. What a moment. In our life. Woo. Thank you.
God of mercy.
Yes.
I promise
we are happy witnesses. Hold it right here. Hold it right there. Hold it right there. Ken, it can't come that easy. Let me see you shake a little bit together. Yes. Hey.
Hey.
Maggie, you can go.
Hey.
Oh, how lovely. How lovely. Oh. Mirabel, graciously, hands are over. Thank you. Thank you.
Can I be waiting for such a blessing? I owe you.
Thank you. How wonderful. Maggie, how are you feeling?
Wonderful.
See, this is the beauty. When you are diamond and you're enjoying this ceremony, there is nothing to be shy. There's everything to celebrate because you know what your heart wants and your heart has received what it wants. I hope Ken echoes that and more. Let me hear my fellow poet.
I echo that and more.
Do you see Ken? He has learned the ropes. He says, I echo that and more. So he should not say something that is not correct.
Welcome, everybody. Can everybody hear me? Yes? No? Louder? Yeah? Okay. Good. My name is Richard Trobe. Ken and I have known each other since 1975, and we've practiced Zen Buddhism together since then. We had the same teacher, and in latter years, our teacher allowed us to start teaching. So Ken and I are both Zen teachers at this point. If we were having the ceremony in a Zen center or a Buddhist temple, there would be an altar here. So I'm going to ask you just to imagine this, to visualize this. And a Buddhist altar usually has three levels to it. On the first, highest level would be a statue of the Buddha, probably gold and shining. Below the Buddha would be a small bowl of clear, pure water and some grain, uncooked, usually rice. And on the bottom level would be two candles and some incense that would be lit during the ceremony. I'm explaining all this because there's a point to it. So we're now going to have a very brief meditation with the ringing of the bell. Today, we come together to celebrate the marriage of Maggie and Ken. They undertake this marriage ceremony as an expression of the deep and abiding love in their hearts. They have asked all of us to join them today as they make public their vows to live together in peace, love, and compassion, each for themselves, for one another, for their friends, families, community, and the whole world. Because when two people truly marry, as groom and bride are doing today, they step forward to help all of us. This ceremony makes public the intimate, open-hearted connection the bride and groom have created in their life together. Actually, this openness encompasses and extends to each of you, family, friends, and community. Without your support and connectedness over the years, they could not stand here today. There's a traditional Buddhist saying that to touch sleeves with someone is already to have karmic connections together for 500 lifetimes. From this perspective, it is not by accident that we come here together today from so many diverse locations, cultures, and situations to share the blessings of this event, but that our coming together expresses and makes real a central truth of Buddhism and of all spiritual traditions, and that is universal interconnectedness. Please stand, and we'll all together recite the traditional threefold refuge to the Buddha, the ever-present awakened state of mind, the Dharma, the ever-present teaching available to each moment of our experience, and the Sangha, the universal community of all beings. Please stand up, everybody, and put your hands in a prayer position like this. Repeat after me. Homage to all the Buddhas who are present in their glory at this assembly. Homage to all the Buddhas who are present in their glory at this assembly. Homage to the Dharma, the teaching, which is present in its glory at this assembly. Homage to the Dharma, the teaching, which is present in its glory at this assembly. Homage to all the Sangha, the community, who are present in their glory at this assembly. Who are present in their glory at this assembly. We will now all together practice a short chanting meditation. Your hands are in prayer position in front of your heart, and repetitively we will chant the name of the great enlightenment being that invokes the spirit of universal love and compassion. The name or mantra is pronounced Quan Se Bo Sal. Everyone say that with me. First syllable. Quan Se Bo Sal. Okay, so we will chant that together following the beat of the wooden drum. Okay. Yeah, just one vow. Yeah. Okay. Now we begin the marriage ceremony proper. To begin the actual ceremony of marriage, the bride and groom will bow to each other three times. Usually they would stand, but because of the train on Maggie's dress, I'm just going to ask them to turn towards each other and bow three times. A bow is a wordless prayer expressed through gesture and action. It is a meeting and a greeting, a sign of respect, and more fundamentally, a joining in the heart. That is why the hands are held at the heart level. When we meet at the heart level, we go beyond the small ideas that we make, hold, and attach to in our self-conscious mind and truly connect. Now, the bride and groom will recite the wedding vows. These are traditional wedding vows. Again, we would usually have them stand, but stay where you are. Okay. The vow of correct speech. You'll repeat these after me, and I'll say a few words, and then you'll repeat. We vow in our married life together to continually break through our preconceived views. We break through our preconceived views of each other and to see clearly. The vow of correct thoughts. We vow to let go of delusions created by thoughts that arise from wanting.
Created by thoughts that arise from wanting.
Holding.
Holding.
Checking.
Checking.
Or making.
Or making.
The vow of correct conduct. We vow to support one another.
We vow to support one another.
In compassion for all beings.
In compassion for all beings.
And to not fall into desire.
And to not fall into desire.
Anger and ignorance.
Anger and ignorance.
In this lifetime.
In this
lifetime. And in any life to come.
In this lifetime and in any life to come.
We vow to refrain from speaking harshly.
We vow to refrain from speaking harshly.
Or deceptively.
Or deceptively.
To each other.
To each other.
Or about one another.
Or about one another.
To others.
To others.
The vow of correct livelihood. We vow to practice peaceful and ethical occupations.
We vow to practice peaceful and ethical occupations.
Ethical obligations. And to support each other.
And to support each other.
In realizing our full potential.
In realizing our full potential.
The vow of correct effort. We vow to overcome our own delusions.
We vow to overcome our own delusions.
And to see clearly.
And to see clearly.
And help build a compassionate, loving home.
And help build a compassionate, loving home.
The vow of correct mindfulness. We vow to always be mindful of each other.
We vow to always be mindful of each other.
And to always start from zero.
And to always start from zero.
so that this practice can become part of our life in all situations.
So that this practice can become part of our life in all situations.
The vow of correct meditation. We vow to support one another in our practice.
We vow to support one another in our practice.
To make our small I disappear.
To make our small I disappear.
And to attain our true selves.
And to attain our true selves.
Which is part of universal energy.
Which is part of universal energy.
And to always further the great Bodhisattva way.
And to always further the great Bodhisattva way.
And now the final vow, which is connected with the exchange of rings. Is there a ring bearer?
We need Sally. Huh? Call Sally.
Sally, calling Sally, the ring bearer. Ah! Okay. A ring has no beginning and no end, and therefore symbolizes the fundamental continuity and unity of life. With the exchange of these rings, bride and groom celebrate the deep union of their lives, no beginning, no end. The rings are now exchanged.
So this is hers, and this is mine. You want to go first or second?
Okay. Exchange your rings.
Okay.
Won't you say something?
Here's a ring for you.
This is the ring of love, respect, and honor for you.
Thank you.
Okay, now repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
In token that.
In token that.
I vow to help you walk the path.
I vow to walk you help the path.
No, I vow to help you walk the path.
I vow to help you walk the path. What did I say?
Of practice together.
Of practice together.
That I will do nothing to hinder our spiritual growth as a couple.
That I will do nothing to hinder our spiritual growth as a couple.
So that the merit of our practice may help all other sentient beings.
So that the merit of our practice may help all other sentient beings.
Both seen and unseen.
Both seen and unseen.
In all the worlds of the past, present, and future.
In all the worlds of the past, present, and future.
The bride and groom will now bow to each other again three times.
One.
Even though this is not true, I now pronounce you husband and wife, and you may kiss each other. Okay. We'll now have a couple of short congratulatory talks.
I don't think this is symbolic necessarily in itself, but it does seem like a rare opportunity. It comes from the fact that my dad has never been one to barrel through life in a straight ahead linear way. I think I've inherited something of this digressive way of moving through life. I've always been on a sort of parallel spectrum, but slightly shifted. A little more violet than blue, a little more prose than poetry, running instead of swimming, more hatha, less raja. I don't pretend to understand the ways in which samskaras form. Something about a stuffed pterodactyl and a disintegrator gun, Calvin and Hobbes and Ben and Jerry, and a bone-deep facility and pride in parallel parking, and half a century spent plumbing the subtle depths of stillness. Things I was never taught, but seeds of karma that drifted down and quietly took root. So somehow this squiggly path leads here to a speech at a Buddhist African wedding that may or may not be symbolic. And I think if you're having a wedding, especially as a more gray-haired couple, at a stage in life when things are supposed to be getting more subtle, you kind of have to believe in symbols and ceremony. I think love has to sweep from gross to subtle to very subtle, body, speech, and mind. couples usually start with one. Weddings are a pretty zoomed out, gross level symbol. Then they work their way down. But Ken and Maggie, a wise couple, already live in both, gross and subtle, name and form, a wedding, now you are married, and the secret interior landscape of partnership, today, 10 years ago, 10 years from now. They have the boon of wise love, and so as a couple, they devote themselves to wisdom, community, and service. And here we all are, and we're all the better for it. I'm glad for this special inverted opportunity. I'm grateful to Maggie for making my dad happier, a little wiser, and for helping him dance a little less like a white boy. Which is all maybe the same thing, happiness, wisdom, dancing. Congratulations, lots of love. Thanks for sharing. Ken and Maggie.
I am Ken's cousin. My name is Jan. And Ken introduced me to the practice of Zen Buddhism many, many years ago. And when I started coming to the Zen Center, I was always known as Ken's cousin. And that lasted for quite a long time. But then lately, as I've gotten to know Maggie, I found that everyone she introduced me to was her sister. So I'm wondering, why am I remaining a cousin? Well, everyone else, no matter what relation, at first I thought she has an enormous family with 5,000 sisters, but now I understand, but I'm still the cousin. Although Ken and I call each other by various names, grandfather, uncle, brother, whatever. And I know that you might have heard that Ken is a poet, and he has a very interesting way of delivering his poetry to his Zen friends, which is that in interviews that is part of the Zen practice, he gets to spend a very short amount of time with each person. But in that time, in between seeing the various people, he's able to write a short poem, and they're very interesting. But I thought I would write a poem and present it to Ken and Maggie in the style of Ken's quick poetry. And it goes like this. Ken is tall, not too tall. Ken is old, not too old. Ken has big ears, way too big. And Ken has a heart, which is two hearts now, Ken and Maggie. So congratulations.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Mary Fossa, and just like Ken's cousin said, in Africa, we don't know aunts, everybody is mom. And I stand here as a daughter to Maggie. My mom is the elder sister, and my mom is Maggie now. Maggie is my mom, my aunt, my best friend. And everybody that has met Maggie have touched their life. That's the type of person she is. She has a heart that is as big as the ocean, that never dries with water. She has open arms to welcome the whole world. If you look at this room, it's a testament of who Maggie is. She welcomes you irrespective of who you are, where you're coming from, what language you speak, the color of your skin. Her doors are always open. That's my aunt. That's my mom. That's my best friend. I lack words to say things about you because I have it in my heart. And I will say to my grandpa, my granduncle, Uncle Ken, I call him all names, that I welcome you to the family the day I saw you and we had a talk. And we love you. And I will say that we are blessed and highly favored because I have a mom, a best friend, and an aunt, and I have Grandpa Ken. with me. So my kids know him. Everybody. So, and now I have two brothers. Hello. So I will say that I am blessed and highly favored, and I love you. I love you guys so much. I think the sky is your limit in everything, and I'm looking forward to see how you guys can transfer what you have in you into us, because we look at you guys every day with the wisdom, the knowledge, and the love, and we as the younger couple, we struggle, but we are learning. So I'd say it again, we are blessed and highly favored because we have you. Thank you so much, and I was honored to speak on your behalf. Love you.
We need to finish the ceremony. Can everyone just stand for a moment? And we will... Everyone stand. Again, put your hands in a prayer position. And you'll repeat after me what is referred to traditionally as the four great vows. Sentient beings are numberless. Sentient beings are numberless. We vow to save them all. We vow to save them all. Delusions are endless. Delusions are endless. We vow to cut through them all. We vow to cut through them all. The teachings are infinite. We vow to learn them all. Vow to learn them all. The Buddha way is inconceivable. We vow to attain it. Thank you very much.
Before today, we know that they will glide easily to the next 15. So Maggie did not, I don't think she had all the symbolism in mind when she insisted to have her birthday. But we cannot miss the symbolic value. To have this cake, which is celebrating her birthday of 60, and her marriage cake by the side. It's telling us a lot. But we'll start with the wedding cake. So I'm going to pass on the microphone to Ms. Asumta Tanifo.
Please, could we all rise on our feet to help Maggie and Ken to cut the cake? And there's one thing I would like to say. In our culture, when a man meets a woman, the first thing the woman does is serve the man with some good food. That's where love starts. It doesn't start with anything else but some good food. And when he goes home, their parents will say, oh, you visited Maggie, so what did she do for you? And he will say, oh, she served me with some good food. If he said, oh, it was just like that, we didn't have food to eat, our parents would tell him, then she's not the wife for you. Because if she didn't welcome you with food, then she would never be cooking. The same thing goes to the men. The men, they go home, and if Maggie visits, they will say, okay. So Maggie's parents will say, okay, so when you went to Ken, what did you do? What did they do? And Maggie will say, Ken's parents received me very well. And that goes on. So the love starts in the kitchen, and they all have told us. So now, this is the time to cut the cake. And please, could we all rise to give them the honor for today? Okay. Okay. This is the time that we're going to witness them to cut the cake and show us how good they are in the kitchen, and also how good Maggie feeds Ken and how Ken feeds Maggie. So it will be a count from 3 to 1. And when I start the count, they will start cutting. 3, 2, 1.
Say you can never be the one. God say, make I tell you say. Say now you him choose in 1 month, in 1 week. You sing a new song in 2 days. Lesser than you will hear. Congratulations, you're in the glory of God. Congratulations, he has done it for you. And you will come back with a new song to sing. God is good. Yes, you will come again with a new song of praise. God is good, oh. Congratulations. 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 Say that the Lord has done for you. Congratulations.
Thank you, man.
Them say that,
do your thing.
That I can never be all that. I see.
Do your thing.
That.
As always, as always. Celebrating diamond 6 decades. And Maggie has had such a brilliant journey. She has so much to show for these 6 decades. And I'll just show another tiny fraction of it. Where's Gina and Mirabel? Where are you? You're part of these 6 decades. Come here. Where's Dr. Mira? Okay. Yes. And Maggie, you are such an inspiration. And it's coming from me, so you can take it to the bank. I have seen you from Cameroon, where you got your first degree, coming out here, getting a master's from NYU, an Ivy League institution. You know, Maggie, you continue to beat the record. You've beaten academic records. Now you are beating relationship records. You deliberately, when you told me last year and said, I'll do my birthday, but I'll join you with the marriage. I don't know whether you were ready for this symbolism. Any woman who is here, these 2 cakes mean something. She's not hiding her age. She didn't come to Ken trying to make as if she's 30 years old. She walked to this marriage at 60 diamond, very proud. And so, Maggie, you're going to cut your cake. And yes, all 3 of you are going to help her cut that cake. And we are going to go in the decades. We'll start with the 10. So this is where we'll make sure that those who have problems with arithmetic, because we are going to go in increments of 10. So we'll start with 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. Oh my God. Oh my God.
Go.
Yes.
Go, Charlie.
It's your birthday. At this point, Maggie is going to throw her bouquet. This is going to be unique. Let me see all the single women here from 18. I don't know what is the age for New York State. No, New York State they on is from 16 or 18. So 18 to 60 and above.
All right. All the single ladies. Are you ready?
John. for six decades.
Everyone that you know, we're sending you all the love in the world.
School na pikin ona shot kwale 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 kwale.
Okay, you can see they've slowed down because they think that they need to be motivated for one thing or the other that
Kwale.
So during this time,
wait
the,
for work another.
The husband to be is going Kwale. To negotiate because you can see that they are not happy. The song has slowed
they
down.
They won't move on for my hand.
So the husband hey. Got to negotiate with his men and
Kwale. Go to say wait.
Now,
no
what
way.
I want you to do is turn around and
no
look at
way.
What the men are doing.
Kwale.
You can see that they are Kwale. Negotiating and they need to go
Kwale.
Do some tips because the woman is held behind there.
Kwale.
She's not going to come in until Kwale. She is motivated. And so Kent has sent a delegation. Ken is sending somebody now. Can we pay attention, women? Okay. So someone is coming. And they have been tipped.
Kwale.
Ken has sent a delegation.
Kwale. Kwale. Namoni.
Okay. So what has happened is Ken has sent a chicken. All right. You can hear them ululating.
Una food hot. Usa grandpa.
All right. So more delegation. The next delegation is going. Okay, okay, right. Right. So what has happened is Ken is playing the game very well. He is negotiating very well. There you go. See more money coming out. And the woman is inching forward. What you are not noticing is that... What you are not noticing is...
There is...
There is a baby, a second baby cow.
Hey.
So what has happened is, Ken has given a chicken. Ken has given a baby cow. And this is conducted in the form of money. So the lady is inching closer and closer. But again, I want you to continuously look at Ken's delegation.
We'll gather the money now.
All right.
May no loss.
Okay.
Kwale. 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 Where? Money fine. Money fine. Money fine.
Right. Right. Hang on. Hang on. What's going on? Listen. Watch, listen, women. Women, listen. Hey, can the women listen? What has happened? There you go. Those are two baby cows. This guy needs his wife. He badly needs his wife. Now, can you see how close they have come? What they have done is, they've given a chicken, they've given a baby cow.
Na happiness, na love. Wow.
Hold on. Okay, right. So you can see that, hey, listen guys, what has happened so far is that a chicken was given. The women were not happy because they thought their daughter deserved more. Ken gave a baby first baby cow. Okay. They were happy with it. They brought the woman closer, but they thought that the woman is a princess. She is a beautiful woman. She could not cross the bridge. She needs new pairs of shoes. And so they cannot bring her to Ken, and they were threatening to take her back. Ben said, Ken sent a second baby cow. And they were happy, they brought her closer. But they thought again,
one, two, three cows.
They thought, how? Wait a minute. All right, okay, listen to what happened last. So they thought, what are we going to do? This woman is in America. She's got a degree, she's got family, she's got children, she's got all this crowd here. She's pulled everybody. We're not gonna give her to you for just two baby cows and a chicken. What did Ken do? He brought out a mother cow. Can you bring up the mother cow? The mother of all cows. And does this guy not deserve his wife right now?
No, okay. 1 second, we just need a car. We need a car to transport her.
Okay.
So we are waiting. Final destination. We just need money to buy the car.
She's come all over so close. Ken has transformed himself into a horse. Ken thinks that a cow.
Bring the bride. Oh, hey, this kind of one. We'll give up.
Right.
We'll give up.
Ken thinks a car is man-made. Ken thinks
our wife, oh,
he can ride. And the wife is veiled. The wife is veiled. What you are not seeing is that the woman has come quite close now. And she is veiled.
Okay.
All right. Wait yet. Just hold on for a minute. Listen, what has happened is they've brought the woman. She is veiled. Ken has satisfied the delegation. They've brought her close to Ken now. Ken will be the one to unveil the woman and watch whether it will be his real wife. When that happens, then you hear a loud ululation. Can you unveil the woman now, Ken? Can you unveil your woman? Go on now. All right. So more money to unveil. One, two, three. More money to unveil her. This is typical. So there's a lot of money that Ken has to spend to get this precious woman. And the women are now satisfied. And they think that he can unveil his wife right now. And he will confirm to us if that woman is your real woman.
Two, three.
Oh, yes, sir. Okay, so traditionally, Ken has successfully.
In the culture of Ngemba, when somebody brings my daughter, our daughter, in front of me, the first message, when I look at the person, I smile very well. As I'm smiling, I call the Latino people. And that is what I've done. So before I will proceed, I have some two or three Latino people here. That is Pa Clement Atanga and Pa Ade. Ade Willem, Ade Julius, I think they should be seated around me so that before we perform the culture. Where is Pa Ade Julius? Please, another chair for Pa Ade Julius and another chair for Pa Clement. Alatinwe! 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 If I could interpret it to us, that they have called Alatinu, they said Alatinu should grow. They have called Alatinu, they said Alatinu should get one mouth. And they have called Alatinu again, they said, for Alatinu, Alatinu stands before any person. Even me, that I'm the sub-chief, Alatinu is before me. So all of us, we have to respect. And that is why I want to thank Sister Maggie, and I want to thank her, smiling, for my pa, Ken, because before I proceed to say something, I am happy to be here. If you look at my behind, you will not know where we are coming from. We have fly from different parts of the world to be here. And there is a reason for that. And that reason is that we want to prepare something. So culturally, if we want to do this type of ceremony, I want to perform the ceremony before I say something. So please, can I get my cup according to tradition of the Ngemba? So what is going to happen here is, in our culture, they say that they should put drinks into the cup. So these drinks, I'm going to give it to Sister Maggie. And if Sister Maggie drinks this drink and turn around and see that he has a husband around here, is going to tell us. But if she refunds this drink to this traditional hierarchy that is here, then the husband should leave. So we should be preparing. So, Pa Peter Obim, Pa Ade Obim, 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 okay, they have agreed. And this traditional oath that we have taken, even if it is word, we are not going to return. We only return when Sister Maggie has taken this drink it, and after drinking it, she will tell us who is the husband or she does not have a husband. So the family of Pa Ken should be ready to see where Sister Maggie is going to give this drink. Okay, Sister Maggie, come forward. Alatinwe! 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 Tap on the beam. We have agreed. And as you are taking this cup from us, when we smile, when we drink and we have accepted the drinks, they have paid you the road until we saw that you climbed mountains and you succeeded and you arrived. So as you are taking this drink, know that for good or for bad, after you take this drink and drink, you will not come back. Do you agree?
Yes, I agree.
And if, do you agree?
Yes, I agree.
So if you drink this drink and come back, our ladies, they are going to put you at the market and shame you. Okay. Now you take this drink, you drink, and after drinking, if you find the person that you love around here, go and give the drink for the person to drink. Just go around and look. Just go around and look. Maybe you change your mind within this time. We don't know. So we want to give you people this blessing. This blessing that I want to pour, it is not on my behalf, but it is the behalf of the Alatinan chief and the notables and the tradition of our culture, Spanish Shona. As I pour these drinks, that any person that has come to destroy this union that we have made today, I have given the drinks outside. This one that I am pouring in the house, it belongs to the house. And if Parker or Sister McGee thinks otherwise after I pour this drink, it will not work. They have to unite they have to always unite to be one. So this union that we have made is unbreakable. It's unbreakable. As I drink this drink, I have drink that I will never receive you back into Alatina. As you see Parken, as you see Pam McGee, I know them in 2013, but we have realized in Alatinan four projects. And the four projects, the solid background is the Zoom meeting that was created by these two. And I give this blessing that it will end forever. Parken and Pam McGee had not only inspired the community that we see today, but they have raised and watched the children in Alatinan that they are watching be fed. And I cry and I say that the blessings of Alatinan will remain on you people.
Sister Maggie, our own very queen mother, Marfo, in Alatinan, was supposed to be here, but she could not make it because she got the visa yesterday. Or in her honor, she gave me this envelope, and this is something that she was supposed to do herself, but she's not here today. So she asked me to open this envelope. It's coming directly from the palace for our king himself. So, demo. Palace of the King, a letter of appreciation on the day of your wedding. Greetings and blessings from the Palace and the Kingdom of Alatinan. It is with great joy that I have picked up my pen with you in mind to make this gentle gesture of a father to son thing. The name Parken is a household name to all Alatinan sons and daughters, as you have proven yourself to be an amazing in-law. You have been there for us and with us during our good and challenging moments. We should have told you before how very lucky and proud we are to have an awesome son-in-law with you, Parken. However, our delay was deliberate. We wanted to do it at an appropriate time. We think this is a fine time to exhibit our appreciation for love for you. On this special day of yours, I, Fon Sufo III of Alatinan Village, sincerely wish Maggie, Princess Maggie Mungan, and you, Ken, a very nice wedding. I do pray and hope you will accept a piece of land which I have reserved in Alatinan for you and my daughter to construct your retirement home on. This is a wedding gift for you both, wrapped in lots of love from the bottom of my heart. Wishing you a happy married life, greater achievement as you take the oath of till death do us apart. From Sufo 3 of Alatne.
I remember the way that she leaned against him with his chin resting on her head, and I thought, looks like they fit well together. And if you've ever seen them standing like this, you know what I mean. A little while later, she asked me if he could move in with us, and I wondered, is he gonna fit through the doorway? Indeed, he did fit, and they continue to fit well together. They have influenced me to believe that the hallmark of a good relationship is making time to just sit together and talk. They talk about life, about current events, and they talk about all of us. It's rare that you won't see them in deep conversation, and if they're seated, he's usually massaging her feet, or you see them just blissfully enjoying good music. I've enjoyed watching the both of you grow and evolve, learning to accept each other fully, including Ken's habit of wiping his hands on his shirt while he eats, and my mom's unique way of talking you into sharing your life story. And I can say that we have become more zen since you've entered our lives, Ken. And in return, you're now fluent in Pidgin and in our traditions. And I will say, I was surprised that there wasn't much of a learning curve for you when you entered our family, when you started learning more about how we do the things that we do. And maybe that's because in the end, you were the right fit.
This is a case where we have two persons who have moved across the land and the seas. They've moved across joyful events and hard times. And I can speak much more for my sister, who made me to know Ken. And all I want to say is, I'll give you just the end of the story. Boys, I don't see somebody there, they say that guy, it made my head turn. And that was me. I was thinking of some guy from around the Santa sub-region. Ebony black with the muscles. and the gray black hair that tells all the handsomeness of a man. And then he said, no, now we go. Okay. We go to see how it happened. And so they had to come home. And everybody was waiting to see Ken, not just see him, but see the effect he would have on our sister. And I was charged with sleeping next to their room, so that in the morning, I'll give the news to the village whether Maggie was fine or she was sad. I never told them, but today I'm telling you, Ken, in the morning when you got up, I looked at her face full of smiles, and then some elderly man told me that in the night, were you hearing some sweet sounds around? I said, yeah, I thought it were the birds. And he said, no, it was Maggie. And so they confirmed that you are the guy for her, and she is the person for you. So that is the love, the sweet love that we discovered back home. And this is it today that has been confirmed. And I call on everybody that we should give a toast, to raise our glasses for this sweet love.
When we celebrate, hip, hip, hip.
We are very, very honored. We are excited. And we are very, very happy to thank God for the greatness with which He has blessed you and blessed Ken. Your union stands in His word. So we ask Nyombom to stretch His hands of guidance over you and lead you everywhere you go from today. Now, when you look at us, we are only just representatives of the alumni of the Yaounde University Theater. It's a big group. So we stand here simply to say that we have your back wherever and whenever. And for you, Maggie, when we look back, we are here, we count 30 years of knowing each other, of sticking with each other. And indeed, we can count 40 years and 40 beyond. So we are just standing here to say that we are glad to report that you have remained true to yourself, you have remained firm, you have remained true to us, to your family, and to the world. Ebullient, gracious, grateful, thankful, devoted, and determined. So may peace reign with you. May love reign in your hearts. May joy nest with you and Ken forever and ever. Thank you so much.
Now the grove where you give me papa, now in this with the sack I'm so. Now the grove where you give me papa, now in this with the sack I'm so. Papa, eh, eh, papa, eh. Make you take them with all, yeah, papa, eh. Hey, papa, hey. May we succumb we.
Paila, paila, ngongo, paila. Aloba ya e paila, paila, ngongo, paila. Oh, mbimo, paila, paila, ngongo. Aloba ya e paila, ngongo, paila. Oh, mbimo, paila, ngongo, paila. Thank you. Okay, we're going to go on with Ken's friend. So, please grant him your ears. Hello? Hello? I don't hear you guys. I don't hear you. I don't feel you. I don't feel you. I hear you, but I don't feel you. Hello? Love is such a wonderful thing. When you find it, love is such a wonderful thing. When you find it, you give it a home. Yes? They've given it a home.
Hello. I am Steve Stern. I have known Ken since seventh grade, 1964. And I'm going to share with you an unknown incident which saved this marriage in 1976, long before Ken and Maggie even met. Ken's mother, Mrs. Adele Cassell of blessed memory, and I literally saved this marriage. Ken had decided to become a Zen Buddhist monk. I shrugged my shoulders and I said, I guess if you're going to be celibate, there's nothing left to talk about anyway. And I went up to see Ken. Ken met me at the door. His first words were, I decided not to become a monk. And we had a wonderful weekend after that. We are here today because of time and chance, and the very fortunate ability of Ken and Maggie to meet and to fall in love. So to Ken and Maggie.
On behalf of myself and my wife, I would like to thank all of you for coming. I would also like to say that it's because of Maggie that I know something about village life. And if you look at the hundreds of people who came here today, they know one or both of us. Each one of you knows hundreds of people, and each one of them knows hundreds of people. And one of the things that's very meaningful to both of us is the way that people can influence people. And if you think about the joy and the happiness and the love that everybody shared here today, that lives here in each of us, you can touch everybody you know, they can touch everybody they know. If you add that up, that's the whole world. So if your heart is peaceful, your family is peaceful, your town is peaceful, your country is peaceful, the world is peaceful. So besides a celebration of love, this is a celebration of influence and a celebration of peace, and we're absolutely joyful that everybody could share that with us. So thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I want to take this moment to just thank my entire family, which is all in here, because we're all related one way or the other. I want to especially thank my daughters and sons that we've all raised in the U.S., my lovely family. We go way back. So I'm going to start by just thanking, I think Florence Reinhardt was here and she left already. I want to start, you know, by thanking her. We grew up upstation in Mendankwe, and the husband was the one that facilitated my visa to come to the United States. And I want to thank my friend Lillian. We go way back in the way back. So I remember when Solomon came to meet Lillian in Cameroon, Solomon had to come to Bamenda. Lee was living in Yaoundé. She had to bring Solomon so I can check him out. So when I got Ken, I was like, hey, Lee, I beg the pastor so make some more achu at the camp. That means Lillian had to make a little achu, and I took Ken there for Lee to check him out. So I want to say thank you to my family of sisters, on whose shoulders I've continued to rise and stand tall. I want to thank my daughters. They're all over there looking all beautiful. And I want to thank our families and extended families that have come from all over. Look at Fred spreading his hands. Yes, Fred. Yeah, thank you too. I love you too. So we want to thank everybody that have come from far and near to this beautiful celebration, because this is truly a celebration of life. It is not just a wedding, it's a celebration of life. So we're really grateful that all of you could come, and we're wishing all of you best of travels and safe travels back home. And please take the bouquets that are on the tables with you, because we don't want to waste the roses. So welcome again, and thank you, and have a wonderful and safe trip home.